The skeletal system is divided into the axial skeleton and the appendicular skeleton. The axial skeleton forms the bones which make up the central axis of the body. Appendicular skeleton consists of the bones which support the forelimbs and hind limbs. Now coming to the axial skeleton. The axial skeleton is divided into skull, vertebral column, ribs and sternum. The appendicular skeleton consists of the limb bones, that is the bones of the forelimb and the hind limb, as well as the limb girdles. The limb girdles support the limb bones. The limb girdle that supports the forelimb bones is called as pectoral girdle or the shoulder girdle, and the limb girdle which supports the hind limb bones is called as the pelvic girdle or the hip girdle. The skull of rabbit is divisible into two regions, the cranial region and the facial region. The cranial region protects the brain. The facial region consists of the sense capsules and the jaws. The cranial region is in turn divisible into three segments, which are the occipital segment that consists of four bones, parietal segment that consists of six bones, and the frontal segment consisting of five bones. The sense capsules are of two types. They are the auditory capsules and the olfactory capsules. Then the jaws. The jaws comprise the upper jaw and the lower jaw. The upper jaw is called as maxilla and the lower jaw is called as the dentary. So first we go to the vertebral column. So here you can see the vertebral column of rabbit, which is the backbone which is supporting its body. So this is the vertebral column. And the vertebral column is made up of a number of irregular bones which are called as vertebrae. And in rabbit, there are about 45 to 47 vertebrae which totally make up the vertebral column. So here you can see the vertebrae, they are arranged to form the vertebral column. And this region can be, or this vertebral column can be distinguished into five regions. So this first region, it is called as the cervical region. The second region is called as the thoracic region. The third is called as the lumbar region. Fourth is the sacral region. And fifth is the caudal region. So cervical corresponds to the neck region. The thoracic corresponds to the trunk region up to the abdominal region. The lumbar corresponds to the abdominal region. Then the sacral corresponds to the, we can say, hip region, and the caudal vertebrae, they will correspond to the tail region. And we can just go to the vertebral formula of rabbit. C7, T12 to 13, L7, S4, CD15 to 16. So what does it mean? C7 means there are seven cervical vertebrae. T12 to 13 means there are 12 to 13 vertebrae which make up the thoracic region. L7 means there are about 6 to 7 lumbar vertebrae. Then S4 means there are 4 sacral vertebrae. And CD15 to 16 means the last region, which is called as the caudal region, is made up of 15 to 16 vertebrae. So cervical 7, thoracic 12 to 13, lumbar 6 to 7, sacral 4, and caudal 15 to 16. The vertebra of rabbit is said to be amphiplatian or acoelous. Why it is said so? So we will just have a look on one of the vertebrae of rabbit. So I have taken one of the vertebrae of rabbit, in which you can see there is the main bony part or the body of this vertebra, which is called as the centrum. And you can see that this centrum is flat on both sides. Here also you can see the centrum is flat, this side as well as the opposite side. So since both sides are flat, it is said to be amphiplatian. Amphi means both, platy means flat. That means the both sides of centrum are flat. or it is said to be acoeleous. Seal means cavity or concavity. A means no. So there is no concavity either on the anterior side or the posterior side. That is why the centrum is said to be acoeleous or amphiplatian. So here also you can see an amphiplatian centrum. So this part is called as a centrum. And in the embryonic stages, each centrum consists of three pieces, which is consisting of a thick middle portion, which is called as a centrum proper. And there are two discs, one in the anterior region and the other in the posterior region. These discs are called as epiphyses. And later, when it grows up, on the process of growing, the epiphyses will fuse with the main vertebra or the middle piece. So here you can see the vertebrae. There are four vertebrae shown here. They are one after the other arranged to form this vertebral column. So this is evident from this picture also, where the vertebrae are arranged one after the other to form the vertebral column. By which part they are united? It is the centrum which unites them. So here you can see the centra are fused with one another to form the vertebral column. In between the adjacent centra, you can see thin pads of fibrocartilage. They are called as intervertebral discs. And what is their function? They are shock absorbing cushions, and they will prevent the friction, consequent wear and tear, etc. of the vertebrae. And we just go to the typical vertebra. I already told you the vertebral column can be divided into five regions. So accordingly, the five types of vertebrae are cervical vertebrae, thoracic vertebrae, lumbar vertebrae, sacral vertebrae, and caudal vertebrae. And it was also already mentioned that all the vertebrae are not alike. They are somewhat different from each other. So we have to study the typical vertebra. And the lumbar vertebra is the largest and well developed in all the vertebrae with respect to the parts and with respect to the size. That is why the lumbar vertebrae are considered to be typical vertebra. And as it was already mentioned, they have got one more piece which was there in the embryonic stage on either side of the centrum. They are called as the epiphyses. And now you can see them fused to each end of the centrum. We will look at the typical structure, where you can see arising from the centrum, there is an arch-like region. It is called as the neural arch. And inside this arch, you can see a canal. This canal is called as the neural canal. So there is a canal seen inside the vertebra, typical vertebra. It is called as the neural canal. At the base of the neural arch, you can see a pair of notches. So here you can see a notch, and here also there is a notched region or a bent region, you can say, which is seen at the base of the neural arch, and they are called as intervertebral notches. When adjacent vertebrae, they closely articulate. So this is one vertebra, this is the next one, this is the next one. So when they articulate with each other, you can see that the notch of this vertebra comes closer to the notch of this vertebra. So it is here one the notch of this vertebra lies, and it is here the notch of this vertebra lies. So now when they come close together, the notches also come close together and they form openings. You can see openings here because of the proximity of the notches. So because of the peculiar arrangement of the notches of the vertebrae, which are seen adjacent to each other, there will be certain spaces left behind. And these spaces, they are called as the intervertebral foramina. It is inside the vertebral column that the spinal cord is protected. From the spinal cord arises nerves, which are called as spinal nerves. So spinal cord is there running through the neural canal of the vertebral column, but on from each side the spinal cord gives off branches. You can call them as the spinal nerves. So how do they come out? It is for their exit that these intervertebral notches come closer to each other. So the intervertebral notches, they will come close to each other and they form intervertebral foramina to facilitate the passage of the spinal nerves from the spinal cord. Apart from this neural arch and neural canal, you can also see arising from the dorsal side, there is a single spine-like structure. So you can call it as the spinous process or the neural spine. Along with that, you can see lateral processes. And these transverse processes are also there in a typical vertebra of rabbit. The centrum also bears paired articular processes. They are called as post-zygapophysis and pre-zygapophysis. So we will just have a look on them. So here you have one centrum. Next is this. Don't look at these ribs now. You just look at the centra. So the centrum of one vertebra is articulating with the centrum of the next vertebra. Then it articulates with the centrum of the next vertebra. Now, arising from a centrum, you can see two processes. This process is called as the pre-zygapophysis. And this process is called as the post-zygapophysis. So each centrum bears a pair of anterior as well as a pair of posterior processes which are called as pre-zygapophysis and post-zygapophysis. They are meant for articulation with the vertebra in front and behind. This is the post-zygapophysis of one vertebra. And this is the pre-zygapophysis of the next vertebra. Now we will just come to this diagram where you can see this is the post-zygapophysis of the front vertebra and this is the pre-zygapophysis of the next vertebra. And see, they are articulating with each other. So the post-zygapophysis of one vertebra will articulate with the pre-zygapophysis of the next vertebra. Just beneath the pre-zygapophysis, there is a pair of large forwardly and upwardly directing processes. And these processes, they are called as the metapophysis. So, metapophysis are pair of large forwardly and upwardly directing processes which are seen behind the pre-zygapophysis. So, here you can see the metapophysis. Similarly, at the base of the post-zygapophysis. So, here you can see the post-zygapophysis. At the base of the post-zygapophysis, there are a pair of small backwardly directing processes. They are called as anapophysis, which you can see in this diagram. So, this is the front view and this is the side view. So, this is the anapophysis, which is seen just behind the post-zygapophysis. Metapophysis and anapophysis are together called as mammillary processes. Now we will go to the different types of vertebrae. So we will first go to the first type of vertebrae. The first one is cervical vertebrae. Cervical vertebrae support the neck region. The number of cervical vertebrae is 7. In most of the mammals, the number of cervical vertebrae is 7, except in certain animals like Colipus, in which the number of cervical vertebrae is 6, 8 in Trichicus and Tamandua, and 9 or 10 in Bradypus. But all the other mammals, even giraffe is having 7 cervical vertebrae. So is rabbit. What are the characteristic features of the cervical vertebrae of rabbit? First one is the centrum will be reduced. Second is that the transverse processes will be short. So here you can see the transverse processes which are very short. And also the neural spine, that is also short. And just like any typical vertebra, it is having a vertebral arterial foramen. Vertebral arterial foramen for the passage of vertebral arteries. Presence of a pair of much reduced and double-headed bony ribs. So that we will come to the stage of ribs. It is connected to the ribs, but the ribs are very less developed. So this is the structure of the typical cervical vertebra.
which is having a reduced centrum, a short transverse process, a short neural spine, then presence of vertebral foramen at the base of the transverse processes for the passage of the vertebral arteries, presence of ribs which are much reduced in their development. Now we will go to two vertebrae in the cervical region. One is called as the atlas and the other is called as the axis. The first cervical vertebra of rabbit is called as the atlas. Atlas is a ring-shaped vertebra without a proper centrum. So here you can see the atlas. It is a ring-shaped vertebra without a proper centrum. And its centrum, it separates from its early development. And it becomes the odontoid process of the second vertebra, which is called as the axis. So this is the first vertebra called as the atlas and this is the second one. In the early stages, this atlas has got a centrum, but during development, the atlas, the centrum of the atlas separates from its early development and becomes the odontoid process of the axis. And here you can see in the atlas that the neural spine is much reduced and the transverse processes are flat. At the base of the transverse processes, there will be the vertebral arterial foramen for the passage of the vertebral artery, as I mentioned in the typical vertebra. So here also there is a vertebral arterial foramen, and altogether this is a ring-like vertebra without a proper centrum. And this vertebra lacks the pre-zygapophysis. Why? In the case of atlas, there is no vertebra in front. It is the first vertebra of the skeletal system. So it will be lacking pre-zygapophysis. Another feature is that the atlas is having two facets, or you can say two concavities. These concavities are meant for articulation with the occipital condyles of the skull. Here we will have a look on how the occipital condyles of the skull articulate with the first vertebra, that is the atlas. So here you can see the ventral view of the skull, where there are two projections or two protuberances at the posterior region, and these two protuberances are called as the occipital condyles, which have been marked here in colors. Now we will come to the atlas, the first vertebra. This is the anterior view of the atlas and this is the posterior view. And on the anterior region of the atlas, you can see two facets or concavities for accommodating these two occipital condyles of the skull. They are called as the occipital facets of the atlas. They will be seen on the anterior region of the atlas. These two diagrams are not on scale. That is why there is a size difference. This is an enlarged picture. So these two occipital condyles of the skull will come and exactly fit into the occipital facets of the atlas. So that is how the skull and the vertebral column are articulating with each other. Any vertebra is having a neural canal like this. And here there is the neural canal, but the neural canal of atlas is partitioned into two regions. There is an upper region called as the spinal canal and there is a lower region which is called as the odontoid canal. And they are separated by a ligament, a transverse ligament, and this ligament is called as the ligamentum transversum. This is called as the upper canal through which the spinal cord passes, and this is the canal which is called as the odontoid canal. It is through this canal that the spinal cord passes. Next, we move on to the axis vertebra of rabbit. Axis is the second cervical vertebra, and we will go to the features of axis. It has got a broad centrum, and the most important feature of the axis is the presence of an odontoid process arising from the anterior region of the centrum. And this odontoid process is believed to have originated from the centrum of the first vertebra, that is the atlas. When I mentioned about the atlas, earlier in the embryonic stages, the centrum of the atlas must have developed into the odontoid process of the axis. That is why the atlas is not having a proper centrum. So this odontoid process, which is arising from the centrum of the axis, is believed to have originated from the centrum of the atlas. Now, the other features of the axis are,
The spine is somewhat long and compressed, as you can see here. So this is the neural spine and this is the lateral view of the axis. And it has got the transverse processes which are backwardly directed. Small backwardly directed transverse processes are present. There are vertebral arterial foramina at the base of the transverse processes. And now we have to look into joint between the atlas and axis, how they are articulated. So here you can see the atlas or the first vertebra. And this is the axis or the second vertebra. These are the neural spines. This is the neural spine of the atlas and this is the neural spine of the axis. So we are viewing from the dorsal position. That is why we see the neural spines here. And now you can see that this is the axis or the second vertebra. And here you can see a projection from the axis, from the centrum of the axis. And this projection is called as the odontoid process. And this odontoid process is articulating with this canal which is present in the atlas. This canal is called as the odontoid canal. So we go back into the individual diagrams of the atlas and axis. Here you can see an odontoid canal. So this is the odontoid canal of the atlas which is separated from this spinal canal through a ligamentum transversum. And it is into this odontoid canal that the odontoid process of the axis will come and articulate. So such a joint we are seeing here, the odontoid process of the axis is articulating with the odontoid canal of the atlas. This type of joint is called as a pivot joint, which will allow the rotation of the neck. So this is the atlantoaxial joint, which is the pivot joint, and this can also be seen in humans. And here you can see, this is the transverse process of the atlas and these are the backwardly directed transverse process of the axis. So this is the transverse process of axis and this is that of the atlas, where you can see the vertebral arterial foramina. These are the vertebral arterial foramina. So we had a discussion on the features of the typical cervical vertebra and the first and second cervical vertebrae known respectively as the atlas and the axis, which form the pivotal joint. Here you can see the ligament which is separating this odontoid canal from the neural canal. This is for passage of the spinal cord. Now we move on to the thoracic vertebrae. It was the lumbar vertebra which was considered to be the typical vertebra of rabbit, and we had a look on the features of the lumbar vertebra. And the thoracic vertebrae are very similar to the lumbar vertebrae, except in that the thoracic vertebrae lack mammillary processes. Mammillary processes are the metapophysis and anapophysis, which are seen in front of the pre-zygapophysis and behind the post-zygapophysis respectively, which you see in lumbar vertebrae, and that is absent in the thoracic vertebrae. Otherwise, it is similar to the lumbar vertebra. And now we go to the other features. Here you can see the centrum, the neural canal, the neural arch, and you can see the neural spine, which is elongated. And these are the transverse processes which are short and stout. Now, one important feature of the thoracic vertebrae which I have to tell you is the thoracic vertebrae, they articulate with the ribs. So we will just have a look on the rib cage. We can see these are the thoracic vertebrae, and it is from these thoracic vertebrae that the ribs originate. You can see the rib cage of rabbit here. So the ribs originate from the thoracic vertebrae, and down you can see here on the ventral side they are articulating with the bone present here, and this is nothing but the chest bone or the breast bone, which is called as sternum. So the ribs originate as pairs on either side of the thoracic vertebrae. And they come down, they bend down, reach the ventral side, and they articulate with the sternum on the ventral side. So this cage-like structure, which is formed by the thoracic vertebrae, the ribs and the sternum, is called as a rib cage, inside which the vital organs like the heart, lungs, etc. are protected. Now, coming back to the thoracic vertebra, here we can see that this is the thoracic vertebra with the centrum, the transverse processes, and it was mentioned that the ribs originate from the thoracic vertebra on either side. So here you can see one rib which is articulating with the thoracic vertebra. And you can see the structure of the rib. This region of the rib is called as the head. And the ribs are double headed. You can see there are two heads on this rib. And that is why the ribs are said to be double headed.
So this head is called as the tuberculum and this is called as the capitulum. And for the tuberculum and capitulum to articulate with the thoracic vertebra, there are two facets on this thoracic vertebra. This is called as the tubercular facet, to which the tuberculum comes and articulates. And this is called as the capitular facet, where the capitulum of the rib articulates. And similar articular facets will be there in this side also. But here in this diagram, we can see only one rib. So the two facets are tubercular facets and capitular facets. The former is located at the base of the transverse process, here you can see. And the latter, the capitular facet, is located at the junction between the centrum and the transverse process. So here you can see the capitular facet. So that is how the thoracic vertebrae provide provision for attachment of the ribs. Now we move on to the lumbar vertebrae. We already had a review on the structure of the lumbar vertebra as the typical vertebra of rabbit. And it is the largest of all vertebrae, that is why we considered it as a typical vertebra. And one feature which I have to tell you about the lumbar vertebra is the first and the second lumbar vertebrae. They possess a process attached from the ventral side of the centrum, and this is called as a hyperpophysis. So this structural feature is present only in the first and the second lumbar vertebrae. The others are typically having the structure of the typical rabbit vertebra which we studied, except the first one and the second one, which is having a hyperpophysis which is attached to the ventral side of the centrum. All the other structures are exactly similar to the structures we studied in the typical vertebra, that is the presence of pre-zygapophysis, apophysis, post-zygapophysis, metapophysis and apophysis, etc. Now we move on to the sacral vertebrae. Here the sacral vertebrae in the embryonic stages are four, but in the adult they are fused to form a single bone which is called as the sacrum. Here you can see a lateral view of the sacrum and this is a dorsal view. This sacrum is actually now a fused bone which is formed by the fusion of four sacral vertebrae. And we will just go to the peculiarities. The neural spines, here you can see the neural spines are long and the zygapophyses are like tubercles. Here you can see the pre-zygapophyses, the post-zygapophyses of vertebrae, they are all like tubercles. Another peculiar feature is that this sacrum, it is in connection or it is articulating with the pelvic girdle of rabbit. So here you can see the pelvic girdle of rabbit. This is the pelvic girdle of rabbit or the hip girdle of rabbit, to which the sacrum articulates. And this part of the pelvic girdle, this part of the pelvic girdle is called as the ilium. So it is to the ilium that the sacrum articulates, and that is why this joint is called as the iliosacral joint, for which the ilium as well as the sacrum will have articular facets to articulate with each other. So this is a sacrum. How the sacrum fits into the ilium of the pelvic girdle. So this is the pelvic girdle and this is the sacrum, and they are articulating with each other. Now we move on to the caudal vertebrae. The caudal vertebrae are those vertebrae which support the tail. They look just like bony pieces in which the neural spines or the transverse processes are not prominent. And only a few anterior caudal vertebrae possess spines, arches, zygapophysis, etc. And you can see a progressive decrease in size in the caudal vertebrae. So this finishes the vertebrae which make up the vertebral column of rabbit, and they constitute the cervical, thoracic, lumbar, sacral and caudal vertebrae. Now we move on to the structure of ribs. There are 12 pairs of ribs originating in rabbit, and they are originating from the thoracic vertebrae. So the 12 pairs of ribs, they will articulate with the 12 thoracic vertebrae. So here we will see a representative diagram, that is, here this is the thoracic vertebra, and these two are a pair of ribs which originate from this particular thoracic vertebra. The part of the rib which is attached to the thoracic vertebrae is called as the head, and the other part is called as the shaft. And this shaft has got two segments. This segment is called as the vertebral rib, or it is also called as the bony rib. And this part of the shaft is called as the sternal rib or the cartilaginous rib. So
this is the head, this is the vertebral portion of the rib, this is the sternal portion of the rib, and this is a section through the sternum. And on the other side also you can see. So they originate as pairs. Here you can see a lateral view of ribs. There are 12 pairs numbered as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12. Of which the first 8 pairs are dicocephalous. Dico means 2. Cephalous means headed. So the first 8 pairs of ribs are double headed, as you can see from the diagram. There will be 2 heads, capitulum and tuberculum, which articulate with the capitular and tubercular facets of the thoracic vertebrae. Here you can see the last 4 are monocephalous, that means they possess only capitulum, tuberculum is absent. So the first 8 pairs are dicocephalous. There is one more classification, how they are attached to the sternum. So these are the thoracic vertebrae and this is the sternum. So they articulate both with the thoracic vertebrae and the sternum. So here I take you to a ventral view where this is the sternum. They are coming and articulating with the sternum. The first 7 pairs, that is 1 to 7. The first 7 pairs of ribs are directly articulating with the sternum. As you can see here, each one is directly articulating with the sternum. That is why they are called as direct ribs or true ribs. Now we come to 8 and 9. So this is the 8th rib and this is the 9th rib. They articulate with the sternum but indirectly through the 7th rib. So this is the 7th rib. This is 8 and 9. Though 8 and 9 are connected to the sternum, they are not directly connected to the sternum, but they are connected through the 7th rib. That is why they are called as indirect ribs. Now we move on to 10th, 11th and 12th. They originate from the thoracic vertebrae, but they never articulate with the sternum. They end blindly. They are called as floating ribs. So, the first 7 are direct ribs or true ribs. 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12 are false ribs, of which 8 and 9 are indirect ribs and the 10, 11 and 12 are floating ribs. So that is how the ribs can be classified. So here you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. They directly articulate with the sternum. But 8 and 9, they articulate with the sternum through the 7th rib. Now we move on to the sternum or the breastbone. So this is the sternum of rabbit, which is long, narrow and segmented. And these segments which make up the sternum are called as the sternibrae. It can be divisible into 3 regions. The first region is called as the pre-sternum, second region is the mesosternum, and third region is the siphisternum or the metasternum. So pre-sternum, mesosternum and siphisternum. The pre-sternum is made up of a single sternibra. The mesosternum is made up of 4 to 5 sternibrae. And the metasternum is again made up of 1 sternibra. And attached to the metasternum or the siphisternum, there is a broad cartilage which is called as the xiphoid cartilage or the siphisternal cartilage. So these are the various parts of the sternum in rabbit. So here again, this is the pre-sternum. This is the mesosternum with 4 to 5 sternibrae. And this is the siphisternum or the metasternum. And here you can see the siphisternal cartilage.